Okay, sir.
So welcome to ISA Telangana PG teaching program. We are running this for the past 4 months. It is a successful program. Today we invited Dr. G. Shekhar Reddy, senior consultant anesthesiologist at Apollo Hospital Jubilee Hills, Hyderabad. He is director of DNB Neuroanesthesia and Neurocritical Care, and he is a well-known academician, and he is a professor of anesthesia at Apollo Medical College as well, and he is executive member of ISA Telangana State Branch. So I now request Dr. Shekhar Reddy to take over the session. Thank you.
Good evening, everyone. First of all, I would like to thank Ramakrishna Reddy for giving this opportunity. He is actually a best friend of mine. I know him more than, you know, actually a quarter century. So I've been associated with him, and he's a, you know, actually very nice person, and very interested in the, you know, taking forward this ISA and Hyderabad chapter and state chapter. He's striving hard to his best. And I would like to introduce the today's speaker, Anusha. She is a young, promising anesthesiologist and a pain physician. She is presently working at Krishna Institute of Medical Sciences. I wish she joins me with Apollo. Don't know. And gold medalist in MBBS and PG from Manipal University. And she did fellowship or European diploma in regional anesthesia and fellowship in pain management and Indian Society of Pain Management. Anusha, please, you can start enlighten the audience about the role of ultrasound in anesthesiology.
Thank you, okay, sir. Anusha. Thank you, Ramakrishna, yeah, sir, and Shekhar, sir, for a very nice introduction. So, good evening, everybody. I'm Dr. Anusha, as I already been introduced. So today, my topic is very vast. It's about ultrasound, which is considered as a 21st century stethoscope. So I'm trying best to brief it out in all the areas which is used in anesthesia. And so my topic for today is potential uses of ultrasound in anesthesiology. So the evolution of ultrasound. As you can see in the picture, the previous stethoscope has been replaced by a modern ultrasound probe with the portable screens, even a mobile phone. The Legrand is the first person to introduce ultrasound in anesthesia, which is used as in peripheral nerve blocks. So the history goes way far from 1877, and first it was used to diagnose the tumors, then in a gynecology branch. Now we have in almost all the organ systems, which as a basic needs for us in anesthesia, we have made it as a sub-branch of ultrasonic course. That means muscular ultrasound and also cardiac and lung. So the CAT type of ultrasound, which was very huge. Now, as I already mentioned, the portable ultrasounds have been handheld. You can use it outside the hospital, but there is a GPS tracker for it, and we should be having a particular license to use that. So this is a probe where it includes 4-5 layers, and the basic element here is a piezoelectric element, which converts the sound waves are being generated from the electrical waves, and in turn, the electrical waves have been produced from the sound waves. So if the hertz are 5 kilohertz, it means the pulse difference is 0.2 milliseconds, and it travels to the organ and gets reflected back. The higher the frequency, as I come in the coming slides are there, the lesser the distance, and a good picture will be produced. So the probes which are being now used is 2 to 15 megahertz, but modern probes also include 22, Our normal sound for the human ear is 20 to 20,000. So it is beyond this. This is as a record for a general physics. We have the scattering effect, the reflection, which is the basic principle for the production of the picture or the image. Transmission and absorption doesn't produce the image. Ray refraction, sometimes it gets back to the probe and it causes artifacts. This is axial resolution. As you can see in the first picture, we have a increasing depth, but the frequency is decreasing. So if the frequency is higher, the penetration is less, but resolution, the clarity is very good. The clarity means it includes axial and lateral resolution. Axial means the above and below structures can be differentiated easily, and lateral is the sideways structures can be distinguished easily. Initially, it was A mode, that is a graphical form. Later, we have developed a B mode, which is commonly used now for our routine purposes, especially for the venous cannulation and also for the nerve block. The Doppler mode is a color coded, where you can see in the bottom figure, the carotid artery is looking red in color because the flow is towards the probe. It's not because it is artery, but the direction of the flow will give the color. And if it is perpendicular, it shows both red and blue. If it is away, then it looks blue color. So this is basically used for visualizing the vessels and also to distinguish thrombus and other indications are there. M mode is a mobility motion mode for the cardiac ultrasound. Also, you can be used to see the diaphragm movement and also the lung movement. So before we enter into the applications, I would like to show you the different echogenicity. The anechoic is something which is dark in color, and hypoechoic is a little bit darker, which is veins are usually like that. And air is supposed to be hyperechoic. Bone is supposed to be hyperechoic, causing a black shadow underneath. Okay, so these are the different muscles, fluid and bone. Nerves, tendons almost look the same. Here are the different probes, linear, curvilinear and phased array. Linear to visualize the superficial layers, curvilinear for the deeper like abdomen and deeper nerves. Phased array is for the cardiac probe. This has a more piezoelectric elements, the phased array, and it relates to the M mode. So here is a beautiful a clipping or a video where I can show you some movements like sliding, and this gives a visualization of the adjacent structures like veins or arteries if we are doing a nerve block. And compression is a phenomenon where we decrease the depth. So during a procedure, we can go with the proper depth. If you compress it, the needle path will decrease and lesser pain will be there. So here is the differential compressibility, where you can see the artery and the vein and the nerve. So nerves are not compressible, but veins are very well compressed. The arteries somewhat, but yet pulsatile. So this is the way you actually confirm the different structures under the B mode to proceed for your cannulation. Rocking is something like you're just angulating the probe, and in the same acoustic window, you can see the adjacent structures. Rotation is from the transverse view, we are turning into longitudinal view so that we confirm our cannulation or nerve blocks for diagnosing the other areas. So tilting is something, again, angulating forward and backward. So this will give a path to see the nerve and especially the popliteal nerve. So applications are, as I told, every field of anesthesia, subfield, it includes. Starting from the airway, the lungs, the cardiac, gastric and vascular. So POCUS is point of care ultrasound, but I can call this as a physiological study, on-spot clinical decision tool, It is an extended clinical examination, unique and expanding tool, safe, repeatable tool because it is non-invasive. So when I talk about a vascular access, we can use or catheterize the smaller veins or larger veins. And also volume assessment can be done using IVC and carotid artery or common femoral. There is an extended ultrasound, venous ultrasound, to see the score of all the cross-sectional areas of veins like IVC, hepatic, portal vein, renal vein, to assess the volume. The venous scan can be done to see whether any presence of thrombus. So in the diagram, we can see the short axis produces a needle tip here, and the long axis produces the shaft of the needle. Here is only the tip. Okay, this is a reverberation artifact. You have to know few artifacts so that you don't diagnose it in a wrong way. So this is the procedural ultrasound where you can actually follow the steps. This is to maintain aseptic precautions, to take all the necessary optimization of the image and carry down with the position and then to catheterize. So here it's a transverse view where you can see the internal jugular vein with the carotid artery, and the longitudinal view shows the shaft of the needle, the guide wire also in the longitudinal view to confirm it. Indications, as we can see in the image, any high BMI patient or if a pediatric patient, like we use a hockey stick probe to see the smaller veins and vessels, suppose a repeated cannulations and you can't find the veins because of the positional problems, you can use ultrasound very well. Further continuing the indications, you can actually evaluate the carotid bruit and monitor endarterectomy results. If anything like thrombus, as I already mentioned, we can record and also see the pulmonary embolism. So here is the deep vein thrombosis. The normal vein above shows the compressibility, but this down picture, it shows the thrombus, that is the hyperechoic shadow within the lumen. And even with the compression, it doesn't get compressed well. So that is the initial starting stage of DVT, the non-compressibility. It's not compulsory that there should be an hyperechoic shadow. Just if it is not getting compressed, then it poses a doubt for DVT. The sensitivity is about 96% and specificity also 96.8%. As I already mentioned, the simplified venous access ultrasound, it shows the cross-sectional view of all the hepatic, portal and renal vein. Depending upon the measurements, you score the severity and to guide for the fluid. So that even after the post-cardiac surgery, we can guide the fluid usage of diuretics, and in septic shock also, we can see the congestion if anything is there. Further advantages are, as we all know, it is non-invasive and ionizing radiation also is divided. We can see the adjacent structures very well. And also after you cannulate for carotid, for the IJV, you can see whether the presence of guide wire is there, and flush it in the during our echo. We can flush and see the presence of air within the chambers, the shadow. The lung ultrasound, jumping to the lung now, we have various pathologies, and depending upon certain artifacts, this can be normal or pathological things are there, and we can diagnose different type of diseases. So here we have a chest wall, parietal pleura, visceral pleura and lung. And these are the areas where we place the probe to see the different fields of lung. Coming to the chest, if any mass is there, we can use with an ultrasound and use for the diagnosis and also for the therapeutic intervention to aid in the ICU setups or thoracocentesis like that. Chest wall hemangioma in pediatric is, this is a picture of the hemangioma over the chest wall. Here we can see the rib fractures. The discontinuity of the white line here indicates the rib fracture, and the diaphragmatic movement also can be assessed. If the waveform is like this, it is normal. The peak indicates the end inspiration. The base indicates the end expiration. If there is reversal of this or a flat line, that means the palsy of diaphragm is indicated. So this is nothing but the transducer rays. It goes and gets reflected, but some of it gets reverberated, that is in the blue line. So once it gets reverberated, the pleural line, as it is shown here, it gets some multiple artifacts like parallel to the pleural line. So these are A lines, and that is normal. But if the pleural line gets thickened, as the white line becomes more brighter, it poses longitudinal lines. Those are B lines. And these are pathological. It can be non-infective or infective, like inflammatory. So depending upon A lines and B lines, we have a protocol, that is a blue protocol, to aid for a different diagnosis. It can be a pneumonia, edema, or embolism, or an asthma. So lung ultrasound, to continue, these are the A lines. And the bat sign, that is nothing but the wing of the bat is posed by the shadow of the ribs. So in between is the pleural line, and sideways is the shadow of the ribs. Seashore, because the lung movement is there, the normal parenchyma is little bit sandy appearance in MO. So that's why it looks like a seashore. The sea is nothing but the static thoracic wall, and the sand is the normal pulmonary parenchyma. These are normally granulous and sandy pattern. So if the glandular pattern is lost, then it looks almost same as static thoracic wall, and it gives us something like a barcode or stratosphere sign. These are nothing but the lung is not moving. So the absence of lung sliding is there in all these conditions. Especially we should remember that esophageal intubation and pneumothorax and effusion. Lung point is something which the normal lung and a pathological lung, the area where you can end the normal lung and starting of pathological area of the lung is something called lung point. So this is a very beautiful video where you can see the lung point here with the static and a dynamic motion of the elements. So here is the interstitial syndrome where the B lines are present here, and initial stage of inflammatory reaction, you have a narrow B lines. And if the infection increases or inflammation increases, the B lines become wider and the gap between becomes wider. So depending upon this MM, it is termed as B7 or B3 like that. So this is a video where it shows a pleural line, neat pleural line with a small B lines. And here is a rugged pleural line with the wide-based B lines. This is more mainly present in the infective causes. So this is a jacked, and that is an infective, and this is regular is an inflammatory cause. Lung pulse, when the lung becomes static, when atelectic, then the cardiac pulses are transmitted, and in the M mode, there is a transmitted heartbeat. So this is indication of atelectasis. So here is the black shadow, that is anechoic, is a pleural effusion, as you can see in this video. So here, this is the lung. This is a pleural effusion, and this is the liver. Consolidation, we see a patchy lung. That is, the B lines are more brighter in color, and it looks almost like a liver. So that is why it is termed as hepatization. So here we see that the lung looks like a liver, and only difference we can make out is there is a diaphragm. So above that is a lung and below that is a liver. And because the lung doesn't have air, because it is consolidated, the ultrasound waves passes through it and it can even show the spine. So here a spine is very beautifully shown, and this is called spine sign. In consolidation further, when the air gets trapped in, it gives rise to air bronchogram. Those are the hyperechoic shadows which are present in the field of lung. So in the CT, it looks black in color. In the ultrasound, it is white in color. So this is nothing but a static air bronchogram where it shows the bronchus with the static air. The air is not moving, only the chest wall is moving. So this is the dynamic where the bronchus, within that, the bronchioles, the air is moving up and down, and this indicates the ARDS. As I already mentioned, pneumothorax, when you see a barcode sign, this is the barcode again, and this is the normal lung. So pulmonary consolidation also you can see with the combination of effusion, atelectasis, and collapse of the lung. These are the pleural effusion. It can be localized or it can be graded as mild, moderate, and severe. So this is the small effusion, which can be, and this is a moderate effusion, which is almost more than 2.5 to 5 centimeters from thoracic wall. And the large effusion, almost 5 centimeters from the thoracic wall. This is jellyfish sign, where the tip of the lung is shown. So the fluid, the pleural effusion can be transudate or exudate. If it is exudate, you can see a brighter and particulate matter within the fluid, the moving within the fluid, and that indicates the infective cause. Fibrin stands, this is diagnosed as an empyema. So finally, we can make sure that we see all these artifacts or the signs within the lung to diagnose as a pneumothorax, the barcode sign. And for like ARDS, we have a B lines, lung sliding, and COPD, we have A lines and lung sliding. Like that, we can use this table to diagnose the pathology. So because of the prevailing situation, the ultrasound has become a no-touch technology to diagnose the COVID-19 patient and to maintain the prognosis in the ICU. Because of the repeated scans, as it is non-invasive, we can see the repeated ultrasound, and after evaluating, we can combine with the saturation and use for further treatment. So these are the areas where corona or COVID-19 patient, we can visualize the various areas. So these are the changes, few changes, like the pleural thickening is seen, consolidations are seen, B lines are seen. This is how it gets progressed. The B lines becomes thicker. So now moving to regional anesthesia. Here we have most common usage, because in and out, there is a portable ultrasound machines nowadays in all the hospitals, and it is safer. Less amount of drug has been used to cause the block. So here is the needle and this is a nerve. We should have a thorough sound anatomy. Hand-eye coordination is must. You should know how to optimize the image. So this will create a successful ultrasound-guided regional anesthesia. Now here in this picture, we see that tendon as well as the nerve almost looks the same. So because the both have a similar echogenicity, but how you differentiate? If you move the joint, the tendon will move, and nerve, it doesn't move, and you can trace the course of the nerve. So this is the transverse view of common peroneal, which includes tibial and the common peroneal and tibial part of popliteal nerve. And in the longitudinal, you have a sciatic nerve with the striations, hyperechoic striations. So out of plane technique, it's a longitudinal technique. Transverse plane or in plane is something which we use it in plane is safer. Okay, this is the longitudinal way, and it decreases the puncture of adjacent structures. So these are the advantages of in plane. Out of plane, advantage is nothing but the nerve is located just below the tip, and the amount of tissue penetration is less, and lesser pain is there. So these are the guidelines to perform ultrasound guided nerve block to increase the safety. We see an INR and coagulative status. Also, we see that we use a nerve stimulator to increase the safetiness. Optimization, we see that all the artifacts like shadowing, enhancement, reverberation, mirror images, the velocity error, all these should be at minimum. So there is one more thing which we have to remember. The hyperechoic, the musculocutaneous nerve is more hyperechoic. Ulnar nerve, median nerve are little hypoechoic compared to musculocutaneous. So it depends upon the myelination, it depends upon the nerve size, and usually the peripheral nerves are more hypoechoic than central nerves. So upper limb blocks, we all know that supraclavicular block is most commonly used. A thorough sono anatomy is must, and the ergonomics should be proper so that we don't have a problem in giving the block. Even the patient should be very comfortable. And so this is a video where we can see that the position of patient is in a proper way. And also the needle is going right under the plexus, then depositing the nerve, depositing the drug. So this is the drug. This is the shaft of the needle, and these are the plexus. So the plexus includes all the cords, and we have to roots and cords, everything. So we have to see that all the roots are covered. Now, axillary brachial plexus block, we see the position of the probe in the axillary region and the cross-sectional view of axillary artery and veins. Surrounding these are the nerves, like median nerve, ulnar nerve on the top of the artery, and radial nerve is usually below. Musculocutaneous nerve, which is there within the coracobrachialis muscle, and that's how we can block the individual nerves. This is the radial nerve and ulnar nerve in the areas. Individual nerve blocks can be done if there is an indication of a specific regional area, which is provided by the dermatome, which is provided by the individual nerves. Lower limb blocks, the femoral is most commonly used. We use a probe which is gives a highest frequency. That means a linear probe, and sciatic, which is deeper nerve, and we use a curvilinear probe. And here we see a triangular shaped structure, hyperechoic. This is the nerve between the GET, that is the greater trochanter and ischial tuberosity. Popliteal nerve is something, as I already mentioned, the tilting is very good in this. It gives an optimization of the nerve image. And lumbar plexus, you see a hyperechoic area within the muscle of the psoas. Interfacial plane blocks is something which is very good, and it gives almost the same analgesic effect as central neuraxial blocks, like for example erector spinae, and increases the decreases the opioid consumption. Also, this has an increased enhanced recovery pathways. So these are certain blocks which are used for various surgeries. The top one is the transverse plane, abdominis plane block. And the second one is the pectoralis and serratus. The last is the facial latter. These are the commonly used blocks, interfacial plane blocks. Central neuraxial block, here we can see very well that there is a CSF. there is anterior and posterior femora, and there is also it is between the L4 and L5 segments of the spine. So you can just mark it and go with the procedure, or as a dynamic procedure, you do a paramedian oblique sagittal plane and put the needle when viewing in the paramedian oblique view. So epidural and spinal can be done both in static and dynamic. Chronic pain is something which is emerging very well. Musculoskeletal ultrasound is a very good course which will guide us to perform the pain management procedures like shoulder pains or any muscular pains, and joint pains like facet joints, or we can even give an intra-articular joint injections using ultrasound. Meniscal tears also are there. So here we see the picture of the caudal, that is the sacral canal, and the anterior sacral foramen, sacrococcygeal ligament. So coming to the airway. Airway is, everybody has faced a difficult airway situation, and ultrasound is something like a boon in difficult airway situation to pre-diagnose it, and also to make us guide for a whether to use a fiber optic or whether to use other difficult airway cut. So here we see a trachea which is in transverse view. Longitudinally, it shows a string of pearls. So I move the transducer more carefully to visualize the cricoid cartilage. And here we see a thyroid cartilage. So the cricothyroid membrane is between the cricoid and thyroid cartilage. It's usually 0.4 centimeters from the skin. On a normal patient, it's 0.7. So this is how we mark it and perform a cricothyroidectomy. And it is also, it aids us to see whether the tube is in proper place. If the tube is in esophagus, you see a double comet tail artifact like this. And if it is proper position, you see a single comet tail. Almost the sensitivity and specificity is 98% to 100%. Further, you can confirm if at all we're doing cardiac resuscitation and ETCO2 is very less. So we can use a lung ultrasound to make sure that the lung is properly sliding. And if there is no intubation, tracheal intubation, that means a static lung signs are there. That indicates the esophageal intubation, that is a barcode sign bilaterally. So here is a beautiful table where you can diagnose this, whether it is an endotracheal or endobronchial or esophageal, depending upon the ultrasound pictures. Preglottic space, epiglottic, that is from the skin to the epiglottis. The distance, if it is more than 0.2 centimeter or 2.8 centimeters, it will give us a rough indication of higher Cormac-Lehan grading. Now, we are going to neuromonitoring. So here, we can usually assess the ICP and also the prognosis of whether the ICP has been coming down or is it the same. We can use it in our daily critical care, neuro critical care field by seeing the optic nerve sheath diameter and transcranial Doppler ultrasound pupillary right reflex. So optic nerve measurement, usually the sheath is continuous with the subarachnoid space. So if there is raised ICP, that means the sheath becomes widened. The diameter of the optic nerve becomes widened. Usually you measure it 3 mm behind the retina. That is the formula 3 to 5. That means 3 mm behind retina, and it should be within 5 mm. If it is more than that, then it is raised ICP. So we put a copious amount of gel using a tegadem over the eye first. And it can also be seen in preeclamptic patients where the values are usually higher. And on treatment, if it is coming down, it gives a good prognosis. So pupillary reflex also we can see indirect and direct. TCCD is transcranial color Doppler. So placing on the temporal area, we can see the middle cerebral artery flow, which is a branch of circle of Wilms. So here we see a waveform that is normally less than 80 centimeters per second. So there is a very good flow here. Depending upon the flow, we see the waveform, which is the systolic. This is a systolic, it is a peak, and diastolic is something which has a stepwise decelerations. Suppose if there is a vasospasm, you see a high systolic peak and the boat shape diastolic decrease. And depending upon this waveform, we even see the internal carotid artery waveform. And if the velocities, we take a ratio of the mean velocities. If it is less than 3, we have a hyperemia, greater than 3 vasospasm. Likewise, if it is greater than 6, it is severe vasospasm. So if a brain dead patient is there, if the patient is going to have a cerebral circulatory arrest, then you see a decreased cerebral perfusion. And here the patient shows the systolic only, the diastolic is absent. And later, after 5 minutes, when the patient has complete brain dead, that means the diastolic reversal is there here. And the middle MCA, that is the middle cerebral artery flow, is very minimal. So here, to summarize the transcranial Doppler imaging, we can see whether emboli are there or whether vasospasm is there, and also stroke in sickle cell anemia. The experimental trials to see whether a migraine evaluation, and also to see in malformations, AV malformations. So the next is gastric ultrasound. We see whether the patient has full stomach. That is very important because to prevent a aspiration pneumonia. So here in this picture, it shows a antrum which is not filled. And you can also use the ultrasound for seeing the placement of gastric tube. So if a patient has a gastroparesis, even if the patient is fasting, then there can be a residual contents. So that can be diagnosed with gastric ultrasound. So when there is a fluid, the antrum becomes enlarged. And if there is a solid, the antrum is enlarged with a hyperechoic shadow within it. Depending upon the volume, we again categorize. There is a 3 grading system, and grade 1, grade 2, depending on the cross-sectional area of the antrum. So, and also, it can be, if it is low risk, that means less than 1.5 ml per kg. Volume, and if it is more than 1.5 ml per kg, it comes under high risk group. Now, the topic, the last topic of the day is the cardiac ultrasound. It is very important for every anesthesiologist to see whether there is any pathology within the heart. Even in the pre-op area, we can see if any major surgeries are there, we can rule out with the POCUS, that is the cardiac ultrasound. And so we have a 4-chamber view. That is, we have a position like in position A, that's a parasternal long and short axis view you can do, subxiphoid and apical. I think these 4 are very well gives a pathology more. So this is the parasternal long axis view where we put the probe in the 3rd or 4th intercostal space and facing the left elbow. So this is how we make sure that it is properly placed, and this is a parasternal long axis view, and this is again we see the right ventricle, the left ventricle, the mitral valve, aortic valve. Also, this, the mouth of the mitral valve looks like a fish. So it is a fish mouth sign, or you can even make the Mercedes sign. This is the strong contractility of the heart. It shows almost the 2 valves. And if the heart is contracting poorly, that means there is a cardiomyopathy. So in this view, we can make out whether there is any left ventricular failure. So if there is a fluid that means anechoic or hypoechoic shadow over the heart, that means a pericardial effusion. If the pericardium is present and below the pericardium there is a anechoic shadow, that is pleural effusion. And in the bottom picture you can see both pericardial and pleural effusions to make it differentiating the pericardial fluid and pleural fluid. In this patient, the mitral valve vegetation is seen. Because of this, there is regurgitation and the congestive cardiac failure has been seen because of the fluid collection. So this is the, that was a long axis, and coming to the short axis view, it gives the cross-sectional view of the right ventricle and the left ventricle. Normally, the right ventricle looks smaller and like a circular. So the probe is placed again at third to fourth intercostal, indicating towards the right hip. So this is the view at the aortic level, mitral level. So here we see that the cardiac contractility is strong. It's very good in this case. But if any cardiomyopathy, anything is there, it's dilated cardiomyopathy here. The chambers are dilated and the contractility is very poor. This is the septum. So coming to the next view, that is a sub-xiphoid view, we again see all the four chambers here. And the probe placement is below the xiphoid. So this is the sub-xiphoid view. If you see all the areas without any fluid, that is definitely normal. And pericardial fluid is surrounding here. This is the hypoechoic shadows. And sub-xiphoid view with the pericardial tamponade is something which has a effusion. Okay, this is the right ventricular compression is seen here. The last view is the apical view. We have again a four-chambered view here. There is also a five-chambered view. So again, if any effusions are there, you see a surrounding area of pericardial fluid, and also tamponade gives a right collapsed wall. So to summarize all the cardiac ultrasound views, if you see the values to be increased, the measured values of the chambers, and also decreased, you can diagnose different pathologies. The IVC volume also you can assess to see the fluid status, volume status. And if it is greater than 50% during the respiratory cycle, if it collapses, that means there is hypovolumia. So this is the different graphical or a diagram form of tamponade or pulmonary embolism. This is a thrombus in the right atrium, the hyperechoic shadow. And again, the pericardial effusion. Pulmonary embolism, where you see triangular and pleural based hypoechoic lesions. And on the right side picture, you see there is a right ventricular dilation, hypokinesia, septal flattening, tricuspid regurgitation. Again, we can see with the help of LV size and function, we can grade the volume status. So in COVID-19 patients, to see the scans, these are the different pathologies we can see depending upon our views and aid in the prognosis. Again, we have used the ultrasound almost in all the organ systems, especially in this era with the present situation. We have used the lung and cardiac majorly to improve the status of COVID-19 patients. In trauma also, to see the right quadrant and left quadrant, and there's an extended FAST, which includes lung. E-FAST means cardiac or ultrasound. When the patient comes to the casualty, we can use this ultrasound to diagnose the problem and guide the treatment. So finally, there are a lot of technological advances. As we can see in this picture, we have a 3D image, and there are also 4D Doppler ultrasound. The 4D ultrasound has been used for fetus. So when the fetus means the fetus heart rate is almost more than 150, and the blood flow within the fast beating fetus can also be viewed. That is the detail of the 4D Doppler ultrasound. Further advances with the mobile ultrasound, and you can see a matrix imaging. The resolution is so complex that we can see a micro calcification within the muscle, and this will have an aid for chronic pain management. For example, like any tendo-Achilles problems, anything like that, we can remove this micro calcification and improve the pain. So to conclude, it is something like a 21st century stethoscope, as I already mentioned. It has a better sensitivity and specificity over chest X-ray, especially in pneumothorax, edema, consolidation, and effusions. Cardiac ultrasound has a central role in evaluation the hemodynamic status and in treating the septic shocks. Combination of all these things will make us a complicated situation to become a smoother or easy way to treat. So thank you very much. I hope everybody will use the ultrasound. Thank you, Lord.
Excellent presentation, Anusha. Actually, it's a excellent briefing about ultrasound, usage of ultrasound in all, you know, faculties and, you know, the departments of anesthesia, all the places. And you have covered even intensive care also. The anesthesiologist is a pivot of medical care nowadays. So he is everywhere, and you have enlightened, you know, excellently. That's great. Congratulations. You have done a great job.
Thank you.
And
sir,
there are some questions for our audience. I think you can see in our chat box. Can you see, or you want me to read out the question for you? Your voice is breaking.
Okay. How sensitive is ultrasonography in assessing vocal cord movements? Is there an application in assessing vocal cord movements post thyroid surgeries?
Yes, sir. Definitely we can use it post after thyroid surgery to assess the vocal cords. And the sensitivity is more than 95%.
Thank you, Anusha.
And especially so, this will be useful in patients where you have difficult airways. You will not be able to, you know, visualize in direct laryngoscopy. That's what I feel.
You can even grade it preoperatively to see whether it poses to the difficult situation.
Welcome. I welcome Dr. Deepraj Singh, sir, President ISA Telangana, and Dr. Satyanarayana, sir, ISA TS advisor.
Yeah. Good evening.
Add your comments.
Good evening, Ramkrishna.
Sir, good evening, sir.
Anusha. Yeah, good evening. Yes. Only thing is, what I was worried was for a new users, how useful it is. Unless you get used to doing after so many surgeries only, then you can make out layer by layer everything. But until that experience comes, maybe it may take a little longer time. I think Anusha can explain this.
I would like to add a point.
Yeah.
Sir, the technology is so advancing for anybody, right. Even beginner also, I think they will be able to perform with a new,
especially with 3D machines. With 3D machine and all, maybe that is more user friendly than the older ones,
the newer machines. And Anusha,
actually,
will
there
add
are two
up.
Things there are two things, sir. First, everybody should first see the scans, do the scans on normal patients,
yeah,
and like how we use a stethoscope, we have to use ultrasound in every normal patient. Whoever we are anesthetizing, we can do the scans.
Yeah.
To confirm our intubation, we can practice and make sure your eye and probe and needle coordination is perfect. So there are various simulators nowadays which will aid the person in doing the ultrasound procedures.
Right.
And the third thing, the biomedical engineers are being very clever now. What they did is to make sure that we see all the areas.
Right.
There is something, a newer Philips model, especially in cardiac ultrasound, the entire image has been scanned out. You have to just put the probe on some fields and the entire image is captured. It gives directly, it calculates and gives the volume.
Okay, good.
And the advancement of technology, actually they are integrating AI into the ultrasonography. And AI means actually if you are doing a itriskeline block per se, and if you put the probe, the moment the structures will be actually, you know, it will be labeled there. You will be able to see there, the structure.
Okay, okay.
Mm-hmm. Pre-procedure right. Videos are also nowadays recorded when you're doing the procedure. Screen divides into half. One half of the screen is your procedure. Half of the screen is already the recorded procedure. That will aid your procedure very much.
It's like a cue card, actually.
Yeah.
Yes, sir.
And that will simplify the things for a new user, sorry.
But sir, anyway, sir, we are actually, I always feel I'm grateful to you teachers because we learned many things on hand and blindly, sir. Our fingers are our ultrasound.
Yes, even
now for brachial plexus block, just yesterday itself, people were trying with ultrasound, two times fail. Then next sitting, when I gave it blindly, it was so perfect. So people are
little. So now Anusha will think.
One needle inside you have achieved. We have been struggling for half an hour. They were new users. They were not very practiced. Of course, if you practice it, that will become.
Can you use amount of?
Yes. Lesser amount of ultrasound. Yes. Lesser amount of the drag. No, there are advantages. There is no doubt about it. Only thing is, we need to ask everybody to do it with that only, with the help of that.
Tatrayan sir.
Yeah, Anusha.
Yes, sir.
Excellent presentation. But only thing is, I missed one third of your presentation because of some problem. But the excellent presentation. And now, as you said, Ira.
On the YouTube.
Yeah, I am going to watch this initial one third of the presentation. I couldn't visualize. But the as you said, is a present era of ultrasound, role of ultrasound in anesthesiology. Now, every institute wish to have all the pages to expose exposure of ultrasound. Very area, many things you have shown, the 3D, 4D and all. So upcoming years are going to be very revolutionized in anesthesia practice, the role of ultrasound. Long back, our ultrasound role was as confined to only airway assessment. Now it is expanded like anything. So, absolutely. But only thing is, as you said, it requires regular training. And the first, any PG has to familiarize ultrasound, the normal structures, normal areas of normal, how the normal and looking from different from abnormal, unless until they do practice regularly. I don't know, the role of even a DLT position, ultrasound has made a change, the size of the DLT. I missed the presentation, but now the size of WMN tube is a width of the trachea more than 18 millimeters if the size is 39, like that. So everywhere the ultrasound role, and particularly in ICU, there is a lot, the difference between X-ray chest pleural effusion versus ultrasound identification of fluid collection. What exactly you want to say, comment about? Suppose visibility, suppose blunting of a cardiac, this is the CP angle, But relatively, it's free water content lung is more in ultrasound. So X-ray chest versus visibility, a blunting of CP angle, or congestion in the CP angle versus ultrasound. What is your comment, Anusha?
Sir, first of all, we can diagnose at the bedside without any radiation and without changing the position. Third thing is, even the mild pleural effusion also can be diagnosed. So, there are gradings, as I already mentioned, depending upon the distance from the thoracic wall to the tip of the lung.
Yeah.
You can make it as small, moderate, and severe. If the fluid amount is greater than the distance is greater than 5 centimeters, almost more than 50 to 100 ml fluid is there present.
Okay.
So very less fluid also we can diagnose on ultrasound, which cannot be diagnosed on chest X-ray.
Then one more thing, as far as emergency about pneumothorax. So earlier the training was whether you have a pneumothorax. The signs are typical of pneumothorax, the X-ray chest time taken, they just put a needle and all. So what is the role of ultrasound in diagnosing pneumothorax, a life-threatening, particularly tension pneumothorax like that? What do you want to comment on this?
Yes, sir. So when the patient is resaturating, and if the procedures, usually we do a central venous cannulation, and if you think we have to see the placement of both confirmation of the central vein, and also if situations like pneumothorax can be diagnosed very easily with the ultrasound and of the pleura, we can use the aid of ultrasound to make sure that there is a proper placement of our needle and depth.
Okay. Very good. Very good, Anisha. Thank you. Thank you. Thanks for once again. Congratulations. A nice presentation.
Thank you.
Absolutely.
Thank you.
Dr. Nasrullah Shah is asking, is there any good book for beginners to learn basics of ultrasound?
Sir, there are actually the ultrasound has become so vast. We have multiple books for the beginners. Beginner book in a cardiac, beginner book for lung ultrasound and nerve blocks. So I can share in the WhatsApp group so that all can be covered.
Even I will share one Sona Anatomy book. I have one PDF. I can share that actually. It is from basics. Okay. For musculoskeletal ultrasonography.
Yes, sir.
Okay.
So thank you, Dr. Anusha and Dr. Shekhar Reddy. And our teachers, Dr. Deepra sir and Satyanarayan sir, all the participants. We have been successfully conducting these PG teaching programs for the past 6 months. This is entering 7th month. This is not without the help of Dr. Deepra sir, Satyanarayan sir, and Chandrasekhar sir, and all the executive committee of the ISA Telangana. Thank you.
And one more thing.
Thank you, Dr. Anusha. Thank you.
Yeah, constantly one more thing. Dr. Arun is doing a wonderful service to the ISA Telangana state. Arunendra is providing a free platform of this dog biz. He's doing a wonderful job. So we are very much thank to him for the continuous support for ISA Telangana state. Thank you.
Thank you, Shekhar Reddy. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you again.
Can you please share the PPT, please?
Sure. I will.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you very much.
Thank you.